Well, my literally earliest memory of the castle, Willie Hood, who was in the South Lodge there, he looked after it after the Clan Society bought it. And when the 18th century wing was up, you could actually get out onto the roof and walk around the roof.
This is very early 1950s, and I was about sort of 8-year-old, and it was in poor condition, no question about it. It was actually in dangerous condition. You really weren't allowed in to play there, but you were allowed to be in with an adult and look round. So it was in very poor condition.
Castle Mingus, seat of the Clan Mingus, has stood in the village of Weem outside the quiet town of Aberfeldy, Perthshire, for over 500 years. In 1488, Sir Robert Mingus, 11th Baron of Mingus, chose to build a new mansion under Weem Rock. The Mingus clan is of Norman origin, having settled in Scotland after the Norman conquest nearly a millennia ago. Over time, the name was recorded variously as Mainers, Manners, and eventually the Scots Gaelic Menriach. The corruption to Menzies happened later and complicates things a bit more.
Well, it's a Norman name, originally Mainerus in Normandy, or possibly just a bit further north in Normandy. It's hard to tell. It appears for the first time in Scottish records as Meniers, M-E-N-Y-O-G-E-R-S, a yog being a y sound, basically. And of course, a yog looks like a Z. So later on, handwriting was misinterpreted. It looked like a Z. It's a bit like the Mackenzies, which in Scots also includes a yog, a y sound, and in Gaelic is Maconye. And it's Menya. And that is how really it has come to be. Why it evolved from Menyas to Mingus is just a question of time and the way in which things move in time.
And locally, it's pronounced Mingus. And until Sir Robert Mingus, the Australian Prime Minister, came across in the 1960s, most of the UK called it Mingus. And after he came across and called himself Menzies, suddenly it became more popular in the UK. Quite a lot of them came north when one of the Scottish kings invited them in, and they settled in the borders first. And they were given quite a large chunk of land up here by Robert the Bruce. And they moved the MacDougalls out at that point, which were the previous family that had this area. It varies as to where they settle. We were told originally that the lesser town hall in Aberfeldy was possibly the site of the first Mingus castle in the area. And then I believe it was Comrie Castle after that, and then the place of Weem.
Comrie Castle sits in ruins down the road from the present Castle Mingus in a private garden. When it burned in 1487, the Mingus began building the new tower house, which became known as the place of Weem. Weem is a corruption of Uav, Gaelic for cave, referring to a hollow up in the crags behind the castle. There is an ancient legend that a Mingus lady was captured by an elvish king. He lived in the forest, and he spirited her up into the cave, and there made her his queen. At the top is St. David's Well, a small spring-fed cistern under the crags. Here, Sir David Mingus, clan chief from 1377 to 1449, set aside worldly troubles and lived the aesthetic life of a hermit.
The first thing we always say to visitors is just look at where it is. It's not a medieval castle on a hill, because it wasn't there to defend against armies or against sieges, although probably it could have defended against a raid, say, for a day or a couple of days. So that's the extent to which it was defensive, but only for a short amount of time and for a few people. But the location of it is very strategic. It dominates this part of the Strath, the valley. It looks grand, it looks imposing, which is exactly what it was there for. So it was more for grandeur and style and dominance than defense. What was here originally, we're not entirely sure, but what we think was that it was a tower house, and there are some that remain in Scotland. That is simply a vertical, straight-sided, small, very small castle-like thing, probably four stories high, and probably made up of what is now the old kitchen, and then the two ante rooms above, and then the top floor as well, just straight up. So there are just square and straight up, probably with battlements on the top. So we see a few examples of those in other places. And from the very few records we have, we think that it was the place at Wem which was described there. And of course, we know that that was burned at some point after some disagreement.
Well, the 1502 burning arose because Robert Mingus, when he came of age, had found that the Stuarts of Fortingall and the Campbells of Glenorchy had been nibbling away at his lands and settling people on them. And when Robert Mingus came of age, he set about getting the land back. And it was that which led to the assault on the castle by Neil Stuart.
What we then had was, in the 1500s, the Zed Plan Castle, that is the 16th century masterpiece that we are in, was erected. And what we think happened is they took the original tower house and they just extended it a lot. So they stuck a tower on the back, that's the northeast tower, and then they extended the original tower house a long way to contain all the main buildings, and then they put a tower on the southwest corner as well. And so you've got that almost Z shape, which is, I think, lovely and ironic, because also it relates to the yoke that's not a Z in the Menzies name, the Mingus name. The reason for the Z plan being that you can go into those two towers, and using your musket or whatever, you could actually give covering fire along the face, the long walls of the castles, to keep the baddies out. And so that was why they were there. They were jutting out to allow you extra covering fire on the main walls. That was built in sometime in the 1500s to extend the tower house. We don't know what was at the top, but we think it might have been originally battlements or crenellations so that you could peer out and fire out with a walkway behind that around, and then a much smaller attic structure in the middle. But what we do know is that by 1577, one of the most ancient records that we have that still exists, from Fortingall, said that by 1577, the current roof structure and the gable ends and all the timbers were in. And we said so that's the first really proper record we have. And all of that work in the 1500s, especially the end of it, leading up to 1577, was a result of a very fortuitous marriage by the then chief, who married Barbara Stuart. And of course, in those days, significant marriages were for money and power and politics more than love. Love was an extra. Barbara Stuart was the daughter of a very, very powerful person. I think at that point they were owning Blair Castle, and there was a lot of money and prestige came in. And that allowed for this castle to really be very splendid. So 1577 saw the Z plan being completed, as far as we know. We have no idea what there was in terms of outbuilding and other smaller buildings. But the next significant thing was in the Georgian period, an extension was put on to the back of the castle. So there was a lot of blocking up of windows that had originally looked north, and or conversion of them into doorways going into the new Georgian. Extension had more cellars on the ground floor, a beautiful wooden staircase going all the way up. It had a library, billiard room and so on, and they would have all connected through to the corresponding floors in the 16th century part. That sadly had to be demolished when the castle was saved from a near ruin in the 1970s. Then the next major and the final major extension was in the 1830s, finishing in 1840, the Victorian wing. And that is that includes the Durham, the ballroom, the servants' hall, this room we're sitting in now. And the Victorians did a fantastic job in that they had a near perfect copy of the original 16th century castle. And if you stand outside, unless you know what you're looking at, you can't really tell where one ends and the other finishes. So by 1840 then, you have the original Zed plan, you have the Georgian extension at the back, and they have the significant Victorian extension on the side, making really quite a large castle. And all the way out the back, now almost all demolished, you had all sorts of stables and sheds and servants' quarters. There was a fire engine shed, there was laundry, there was game room, there were cellars and so on. And they stretched a long way back past what is now the boundary for the castle, right back through the field, almost to the neighbouring property behind us.
They were all trying to sell. When Queen Victoria got married, and she visited here in 1842 in her extended honeymoon, well, visited the area she stayed at, Teignmouth Castle, they were all building Victorian wings to try and impress her. They knew she wanted a castle in Scotland, and they were all trying. She spent fortunes to try and impress her, and she went up to Balmoral, bought Balmoral, and Albert knocked the whole thing down, the castle down, and started again up there.
By the early 1700s, due to a failed business venture with a relative, Robert Mingus, 3rd Baronet, had to sell off his lands on the south side of the River Tay, reducing the social standing of the Mingus chiefs. Having no male heir, his succession fell to his cousin, Sir John Mingus. Sir John had made money in the West Indies and paid off the debts that he inherited. More additions to the castle and gardens left still more inherited debts, so that by the mid-1850s, the Mingus family moved to Far Layer and leased the castle for shooting parties. Queen Victoria and Prince Albert had created the romantic idea of Scottish living in the mid-19th century, so Castle Mingus soon found itself leased by the likes of Helen, Queen of Romania, the Rothschilds, and the last Maharaja of the Sikh Empire, His Highness Juleep Singh.
Well, he was only here briefly. I mean, the story of Juleep Singh is a rather sad one, because he was the last Maharaja, He was really brought up by the British away from his family to make sure that he was not a figurehead for any attempt at independence by the Sikh area. So he was kept away from his native land, but he was quite well looked after here. He was educated here. He got on well with the royal family, but he really was under the control of his guardians here, and it was they who arranged for him to come and occupy Mingus Castle for a shooting season here. And he came here, and they were friendly with the Campbells of Breadalbane and with the Earl of Athol as well, and Mingus. So he was a crack shot, an absolute crack shot, and he loved stalking and shooting up here. So one of his occasions was here at Castle Mingus. He was the person who gifted the Koh-i-Noor diamond, one of the finest diamonds in the world, to Queen Victoria when he was about 14 and a half, 15, which indicates that he might have been persuaded to do so by his guardian rather than a purely spontaneous act of gratitude.
By the turn of the 20th century, Chief Sir Neil Mingus, 8th Baronet, had borrowed extensively against the security of the vast Mingus estates. In 1910, he died without heir, and his sister, Miss Egidia Mingus, was elected Clan Chieftainess by the Mingus Clan Society. In 1918, Miss Egidia passed away without heir, and the name and title became dormant. By 1914, the decision had been made to sell off all Mingus lands, as well as the castle and all its contents. In May 1913, the silver from the castle was sold in Edinburgh. Then in October and November, all furniture, books, paintings, and even the wine and spirits were auctioned off. In March 1914, all historical charters and manuscripts were sold. The majority of Mingus Castle and lands were put up for sale in 1914, and the Rannoch Estates, 71,543 acres, were sold. The castle and remaining estates, 11,000 more acres, were not sold until the 16th of May, 1919, bringing an end to over 500 years of Mingus clan rule in central Scotland.
Well, although the chiefs of Clan Mingus were not particularly prone to big spending in Edinburgh or London, they did spend quite a lot of money on their own estate. They reforested it a lot, and they built lodges. That is an indication of the kind of spending that was being carried on even as the estates got more and more in debt. And the end of the 19th century was a period of agricultural difficulty, because by this time crops were coming, corn and grain were coming in from America, from Canada, from Australia, and competing very advantageously with what could be produced here. So there's a big problem in late Victorian Britain for people who relied upon agriculture for their income. So they began to borrow money from insurance companies and banks, and gradually the interest and so on just brought them down. It had to be sold. They went bankrupt, in fact. Well, it was sold in lots. The first lot that went away was Rannoch, and then the bit around the castle and the Weem estates. But of course, it was during the war by this time, so it was a difficult time to sell estates. The condition was extremely poor. It had been used during the war by the Polish troops for storing medicine and as a motor pool for vehicles here, with a small number of small garrison here. And there is still Polish graffiti in some of the upper rooms on the wall. Not much of it, but just a little bit of it left.
In 1956, the Mingus Clan Society formed out of the remnants of the previous society that had been dormant for over 30 years. With the castle back in Mingus ownership, there was work to be done to save it. A lot of work.
There was a meeting inviting clan members to come to Aberfeldy in 1957 after the chief had been pronounced chief by the Lord Lion King of Arms. And I wonder if anybody who was there would like to stick their hand up. My father was there, and then there's this very juvenile script with my name underneath it. Because I was only, I think, 13 or something like that. Although it was probably more legible than it is now. And that meeting also gave them permission, in fact encouraged them, to try and buy the castle. So that is what they set out to do. And they approached the McDermott family, who farmed next door and owned the castle. Negotiations were impossible, frankly. They tried their best to get more land than 15 yards around the walls of the castle, but they weren't successful. But they did raise, they got the money, and they bought the castle in February 1958. So there they are, they've done it. They've actually bought the castle.
Mingus Clan Society membership increased over the years, and through the hard work of members of the society, the castle began to clean up nicely.
the condition was quite bad. There was no lead in the roof. So what happened was the water got down between the 18th century wing and the original 16th century wing, the Z plan. So it got down between the gap between them. It got into the 18th century wing because it was a thinner wall. What they had done, being Menzies, they didn't lock the walls together. They built two walls side by side. So they had the original wall and they built another wall. Water got down there. It went in both ways. When I started working here in the early 70s with tour guides and various other things, even the Victorian wing was still, it was relatively safe, apart from it slowly but surely the water got from the top to the bottom, but it was quite bad in the other two wings. So they got permission, somehow or other, to knock the 18th century wing down. It made it difficult when we opened up because all the toilets were in the 18th century wing, so all the plumbing went with the 18th century wing as well. So we had no toilets at the start in here at all. And as you know, visitors usually like toilets, and in the 1970s they liked toilets as well.
But it was such a huge undertaking for a society which really had no reserves at all that there wasn't much that could be done except to mitigate the damage that was being done by rot continuing to progress in the bit. And that's why we had to pull down the bit at the back and preserve the Victorian wing and the 16th century part of the building, which incorporates a 15th century core in it.
Luckily, the Victorian wing, they built to last and it was still salvageable. And the original 16th century Z plan part was also okay. Even the roof timbers, 1500 roof timbers were still salvageable, which is fantastic.
I do remember personally helping a bit. I was involved in picking out the stones in the big chimney in the kitchen, which originally was a small Victorian iron one, only about three feet long. And we gradually pulled it out, and it was filled with stones. And we used to have a big, long rod with a hook on it, and we used to go into the chimney, do that to the stones, and then jump out when they came crashing down.
I remember my mum coming home one day from an expedition, weekend expedition to the castle, where she was quite excited about having discovered the kitchen fireplace. It's a beautiful big arched fire. The English would probably call it inglenook, but it's much, much bigger than that. You can walk into it, sit into it. Those of you who have seen it know how big it is. And when you walk in there and look up, you see the sky, a big rectangle at the top. So obviously, previous tenants had boarded that up completely. It was completely hidden. The society didn't know it was there. And armed with their little chisels and hammers, my mum and dad opened that up. They tore away the plasterwork that was there.
And then I remember another time doing some work up in one of the turrets, and it had been blocked off with wood, and I opened it, and there was a snowy owl's nest in there. And an angry, snowy owl on a nest is a frightening thing, I can tell you.
I think it was probably maybe 1964, maybe 1968 was the first time I remember going there. And Bill and Andura just started coming to the castle to try and renovate it. They were very very prim and proper, and she wanted everybody who came to help out, not just to come and look. So my first jaunt there, she gave me a small pickaxe, probably only about that size, and said, if you go into this room at the back of that wall, I'm pretty sure there's a staircase because you've looked from the other side. So if you manage to find at least one set of steps at the back there, I think Luke was given the same challenge once, then you can have lunch. And I was just left there in the cold and the damp as a young child, not at all interested, and did my bit, hacked and banged and crashed around a bit with help from some other people and found a step. Then I got excited and found another step. And I think at the end of about 3 weeks, there were five steps going up the back of the wall to a door, and we didn't go any further, and we still have never gone any further. There's just a blank wall there, which must have gone into the old Victorian wing. So that was my first experience. Cold, damp, strict lady, not my best place, but we did get sandwiches.
There was a skylight on the top floor, and you just went into the attic on the top floor, and that would, where the flagpole is, and that would take you out onto the roof, and you could wander around the roof. It wasn't the safest thing to do, bearing in mind I've just told you that everything below you was rotten. And the other thing, this wing here, because the worst part of the Victorian wing was the bit between the stairwell that we crossed into the floors, and that was all rotten. I take it the water had come down the stairwell, and it was boards that were laid down, so you're walking across boards. Once you got onto the floor in these two rooms, the floor was actually quite good at that point here.
Audrey Mingus Payton was there. Audrey was doing an awful lot of work at that time. It has done for years. My grandma was kind of keen on coming. She was a Mingus. She was Annie Emily Gordon Mingus. She was the lady whose grace we say at the AGM, Dad's mother. And my father wasn't particularly interested at the time, and my mother wasn't really interested, but they got more keen. And the Clan Society has been instrumental in getting people in. They're the membership puller-inners. And it's been really important. Each of us were tasked at one point with bringing in at least 10 members. I think each of us may have brought one or two. I know I mail shot 32 Minguses in the south of England and had one reply. It was just really dismal. People see a letter and they assume it's for money, which it kind of was, and they don't reply. So it's been really, really difficult. But today, at the end of this weekend, I've got two new members. So the Clan Society is really, really important. I would like it to expand. I'd like to get more members. We're just so lucky to have something wonderful. We have this castle, so we just have to preserve it for our children, their grandchildren.
Every year in August, the Mingus Clan Society holds a family event at the castle. Members of the society from all over the world attend the four-day gathering to meet other Mingus for whisky tasting, dining and dancing, and to learn about their family history, to connect to the past, to the present and to the future.